chancel choir begins our service with a call to worship. To have you in the house of the Lord as we kick off many of our programs with the rally day. We have a lot of fun things planned inside to keep you dry. So we are going to continue with our service with our opening song. It's in your hymnals. So for you contemporary folks, this is the moment to flex the reading muscles and the holding book muscles here. So open it up to hymn 546 as we sing "To Be Your Presence." We're going to continue with this chorus led by our praise band.
Like never before.
God, we worship you. We give you thanks for gathering us here among your people to worship your holy name. Bless this time together. Bless this gathering. May it be holy. In your name we pray. Amen. You may be seated as we continue with our scripture.
I talked to him about it. I knew he was around.
A reading from the letter of James. My brothers and sisters, do you with your acts of favoritism really believe in our glorious Lord Jesus Christ? For if a person with gold rings and in fine clothes comes into your assembly, and if a poor person in dirty clothes also comes in, and if you take notice of the one wearing the fine clothes and say, "Have a seat here, please," while the one who is poor you say, "Stand there or sit at my feet," have you not made distinctions among yourselves and become judges with evil thoughts? Listen, my beloved brothers and sisters. Has not God chosen the poor in the world to be rich in faith and to be the heirs of the kingdom that he has promised to those who love him? But you have dishonored the poor. It is not the rich who oppress you. It is not they who drag you into court. It is not they who blaspheme an excellent name that was invoked over you. You do well if you really fulfill the royal law according to the scripture. You shall love your neighbor as yourself. But if you show partiality, you commit sin and are convicted by the law as transgressors. For whoever keeps the whole law but fails in one point has been accountable for all of it. For the one who said, "You shall not commit adultery," also said, "You shall not murder. Now, if you do not commit adultery, but if you murder, you have become a transgressor of the law. So speak and so act as those who are to be judged by the law of liberty. For judgment will be without mercy to anyone who has shown no mercy. Mercy triumphs over judgment. What good is it, my brothers and sisters, if you say you have faith but do not have works? Can faith save you? If a brother or sister is naked and lacks daily food, and one of you says to them, "Go in peace, keep warm, eat your fill," and yet you do not supply their bodily needs, what is the good of that? So faith by itself, if it has no works, is dead. The word of the Lord. Thanks be to God.
I invite you to stand as we prepare for our gospel.
Listen, listen, God is calling, for the word inviting, offering forgiveness, comfort and joy. Listen, listen, God is calling, for the word inviting, offering forgiveness, comfort and joy. Jesus gave his mandate, share the good news, that he came to save us and set us free. Listen, listen, God is calling through through the word inviting, offering forgiveness, comfort, and joy.
From there, Jesus set out and went away to the region of Tyre. He entered a house and did not want anyone to know he was there. Yet he could not escape notice. But a woman whose little daughter had an unclean spirit immediately heard about him, and she came and bowed down at his feet. Now the woman was a Gentile of Syrophoenician origin. She begged him to cast the demon out of her daughter. He said to her, "Let the children be fed first, for it is not fair to take the children's food and throw it to the dogs." But she answered him, "Sir, even the dogs under the table eat the children's crumbs." Then he said to her, "For saying that, you may go. The demon has left your daughter." So she went home, found the child lying on the bed, and the demon gone. Then he returned from the region of Tyre and went by way of Sidon towards the Sea of Galilee in the region of Decapolis. They brought to him a deaf man who had an impediment in his speech, and they begged him to lay his hand on him. He took him aside in private, away from the crowd, and put his fingers into his ears, and he spat and touched his tongue. Then looking up to heaven, he sighed and said to him, "Ephphatha," that is, "be opened." And immediately his ears were opened, his tongue was released, and he spoke plainly. Then Jesus ordered them to tell no one, but the more he ordered them, the more zealously they proclaimed it. They were astounded beyond measure, saying, "He has done everything well. He even makes the deaf to hear and the mute to speak." The Gospel of the Lord.
Listen, listen, God is calling. Through the word inviting, offering forgiveness, comfort, and joy. Listen, listen, God is calling. Through the word inviting, offering forgiveness, comfort, and joy. Help us to be faithful.
So as I read this text from James, we started the letter of James last week, we're continuing it today. As I read through it this week, there was a story that kept recurring in my mind that I kept thinking about. And it happened on the youth mission trip in Washington, D.C. a couple summers ago. Karl, one of our members who's a part of the band and is also a leader in the youth group, she and I were running an errand early in the morning on our trip. The kids were still waking up, luckily for them, getting breakfast. But we had to be out and about, and we were walking down the street in D.C. And as we were talking, I started to feel like something's happening on the street. There's something's going on, and started to notice that people had stopped and were watching or staring at one particular spot. And as we got closer, we also slowed down and we stopped to look to see what it is everyone was staring at. And across the street was an alleyway, and at the end of the alley was a woman who was in a heap, fallen to the ground and crying out in pain. We asked the man nearest to us, who looked like he was a security guard from one of the buildings, "What happened? Did you see what happened?" And he said, I'm not sure, some kind of altercation had happened. A man and her had gotten into an argument. Maybe she was trying to take something from him, but he hit her, and then she fell, and she hasn't gotten up again. And we stood there a little longer, and kind of, as I took in the details, I started to notice some other things. I noticed that she appeared to me, if I were to guess, I would have guessed she was a trans woman. And then I also started to guess that she was probably homeless, just based on it looked like she had spent the night somewhere that wasn't all that clean. And I took in these details, and she wasn't getting up, and she was crying out. And I started thinking, is nobody going to go over there? Is nobody going to go ask if she's okay? Is no one going to go check in? Is everybody just going to stand around and watch? And wait, having called 911, but no one goes to her? And then, of course, pretty quickly after that, I think, well, am I gonna go? Am I gonna go and see and check, and is she okay, and ask her, are you okay? And so I turned to Carol and I said, Carol, let's go. And Carol's a trooper, so she's like, okay, Pastor Liz. And we stepped off the curb. We stepped off the curb, and we crossed the street, and we got closer to her, and I crouched down. I said, are you okay? Someone's coming. Help is on the way. Are you okay? And we just waited there with her, and she didn't say much to us at all. She just kept crying out and screaming at the guy who had hit her. But we just stayed there and waited with her, and it was a moment that stuck.
I like the physical sort of vision of that story of having this crowd around someone alone in the center, and that person alone in the center needing you, and the whole crowd trying to figure out what they're going to do about it. Because I know what that crowd feels like, right? I mean, you know what it's like in there, where you're thinking, well, I don't know, it's not my stuff to get involved with, or. I don't know what people are crazy nowadays. They got guns and knives and who knows. And a guy that they fought with, I don't want to get him on my bad side. And then you even start kind of evaluating the situation. Well, maybe, I don't know what trans, she looks different. And I don't think I want to get involved there. Or homeless, right? I mean, oh my goodness. I mean, she's homeless. She's probably brought this upon herself, or she's just going to get in another thing after that. I mean, all these things go in, because you don't have like 20 minutes to debate it, right? You got like a second.
Yeah.
And the thing that could have made a difference possibly for that crowd, I got to believe, is if that woman would have looked like them. Mm-hmm. Or like who they aspire to be. Because then you're far more likely to get off that curb like you and Carol did. And because that's what James is saying, right? You celebrate those people that come in that look like you, that are wealthy and rich.
Got their Sunday best on.
To ignore the rest.
Yeah, yeah. Yeah, and I think all those motivations, right, they just turn in your mind and your heart. And Carol and I could have certainly just kept walking, right? We could have just stopped, said, oh, someone called 911, okay, good, and kept walking. Or we could have stopped and stood there and just kept watching, right? And kept staying there with everybody else who was standing there and watching. And you even said something to me this week, like, yeah, because no one expects you to do what they're not doing.
Right?
No one's going to look at you funny because you aren't doing the very thing that they're not doing.
But what happens when you stay in the crowd?
Nothing changes.
Nothing is
different.
And when nothing changes, that's what dead faith looks like. That's the word James used, right? Your faith is dead. Your faith is dead when nothing changes around you, even though you say, I believe.
Yeah.
That's what dead... And we've conformed with the world. We're okay with the world. We're not going to be part of the transformation of the world. Nothing changes.
Yeah.
And our faith is dead.
We're comfy there. And that's where the whole letter of James is what he's really dealing with, point after point, you know, saying to the community of faith, you know, you say you follow Jesus, then how come you keep treating the wealthy person who walks in the door like they are the best thing ever, and you shame and dishonor the one who is poor or marginalized or different, and maybe you just simply ignore them. But this feels like what the decision was facing us that day, Karl and I, as we stood there, you know, God saying to us, you say you follow me, right? You say you care for the orphan and the widow, for the poor, so go live it. Faith without works is dead, you know, step off the curb, leave the crowd.
There's a decision that has to be made, right? And we think about decision theology being I'm deciding to get baptized, or I'm deciding to say a believer's prayer, that it's one decision we make in our lives and it's over. But it's not. It's thousands and thousands of decisions that you make every day. And in order to make a decision for God and all those different opportunities and all those different times, it's all about what you desire the most, right? Mm-hmm. Do I desire the most to be comfortable in this crowd and not stepping out of it? Mm-hmm. Then I've made my decision. Do I desire the most to protect my safety because I don't know what kind of mess that's going to be? Then I've made my decision of who mm-hmm. I desire. Do I desire the most to be more open to people that look like me and less open to people that I don't know about? Mm-hmm. Then I've made my decision. What do you desire the most in your life?
Yeah, and our faith is saying, you know, the God who is in you, right? The faith of Christ that is in you is stronger than these things. You know, live it. And I think that decision is more than just, you know, big moments, right? Altercation in the street. It's the small things too, the daily things that come against us and say, you know, you've got conflicting desires going on in you. What or who are you going to listen to most yeah. in that moment?
Yeah, because at the end of the day, what you desire the most is what you trust your life with. Mm-hmm. Isn't that right? I mean, and what you trust your life with is who your God is. Yeah. You know, we tell you not to worship other gods, and I know you envision, you know, little gold objects with diamonds in their belly buttons, but that's not what other gods are. And other gods are just those desires that are more important than your desire to draw near God.
Yeah. And that's also James's point, you know, that he's bringing up this thing of what is most life-giving to us is not intellectually assenting to some idea or belief, right? It's not, there's not much life or liberation in that. What's life-giving and liberating is living into it, you know? Living into it, following Jesus one foot at a time on this walk.
And when you say, Liz, what is life-giving and liberating, I think the next question that has to be asked is whose life is being given and what life is being liberated?
Yeah, and I think for me, that's the most moving or beautiful place in the story, because I don't know whether this woman will remember Karl and I, whether she'll know our faces, whether this moment for her, this experience, is anything but a horrible, horrible experience. I don't know if it changed or transformed her at all, but what I do know is that it changed Karl and I. That we were the ones who were changed. That when I told Karl that I was going to be sharing this story today, her very first words to me were, I will never forget. I will never forget. And I won't either. And that's what life-giving faith is. That's what is liberating for us is finding out, yeah, we can move outside of our comfort zones and we can resist those temptations to slide on by and hide in the crowd and we can step out and find that God's got us. And then Karl she wrapped it up by also saying, and we helped Jesus that day.
That's it, exactly, right? What we often say is that we want to be Jesus in the world, right? I want to be Jesus. Well, what would Jesus do is what we say. But what Carol's really pointing out is that when we draw close to someone in need, that person in need is Jesus, and that's who we're helping. Go back to that picture I give you, right, of this crowd surrounding this sole person in the middle, watching her suffer. Doesn't that sound like the cross to you? Doesn't that sound like Jesus on the cross with the crowd around? Mm-hmm. I mean, this is who Jesus is. It's the suffering woman that needs us. And when we draw close, when we encounter Jesus, the scripture says, our life is changed and we're liberated.
That's the whole gospel, right? The encounters with Jesus changes the one who encounters him. I'm very aware, though, that none of that's running through my brain right in the moment, like in the 10 seconds where you're thinking this. It's just this decision. It's this, will I respond or not? You know, will I follow God in this way or not? Step off the curb?
Will I step off the curb or will I stay in the crowd? And this week I was racking my brains to come up with a step off the curb story to match Pastor Liz's, so you wouldn't be disappointed in me. And all I got are crowd stories. All I got are crowd stories. I as much as I thought about it, I could tell you a quick one that just happened just a few months ago at the food pantry, Heart Food Pantry, where I work all the time as a volunteer. I do intake when I volunteer, which means I'm the guy that's in the waiting room when people come in, and we call people that come in to be served neighbors, and we call people who serve neighbors. So we're just neighbors helping neighbors. So when a neighbor comes in, I try to be welcoming. I try to put them at ease. If I know their names, and I know a lot of people's names, I greet them by name, and I ask something about their life because I know a lot about their lives too. And that's what we want Heart to look like. But in July, someone came in, and the first thing out of her mouth, a young woman, she said, I had to miss my appointment on Monday, and they said I could come in on Wednesday. And I'm thinking, well, that's not the way we run Heart Food Pantry, right? So I have her sit down, and I'm kind of suspicious of the story right from the start, and eventually I'm able to have her, invite her to my table that I have with the computer screen in front of me. And as she's talking, and she just starts unloading the story about what had happened on Monday and why she had to miss Monday night, and it wasn't her fault, and these things went on. And I'm the whole time I'm saying yes, yes, and I'm looking at my screen and I'm calling up her name, and I'm seeing she doesn't have an appointment like she's saying that she does. And on her screen that she can't see, she can just see the black back of this thing. It says she cannot have another appointment for a month. Someone had written that note on her name. And so I do my best authoritative voice, right? Because I know this ain't going to go good. And I go, I'm sorry, we can't serve you today. You're going to have to come back in a month. We'll make an appointment for you in a month, and then we'll serve you. She says, oh my gosh, you got to serve me today. We need these groceries. It's the middle of the month, and I don't get my check until the end of the month, and you got to be able to. And someone told me that. I go, ma'am, there is no one that told you you could be served today. That's not how it works. Oh, there was someone who told you. Who are you to tell me? Are you calling me a liar? No, ma'am, I'm not calling you a liar, but it says right here. And it went on like this, and I got more and more stern with her in order to quiet her down. And the whole waiting room is watching. And then she bursts into tears, right? And when she bursts into tears, I go, oh, gosh. Now this really makes me look like a jerk, right? My first thought, not that she was hurting, but that I look like a jerk. And I go, okay, well, I'm going to help her because I don't see any other way of getting her out of here without dragging her out. So I go, okay, ma'am, we are going to help you today, but you can't do this again. You must not do this again. I'm going to help you, but this is a big sacrifice for us here at Heart. And then a really nice neighbor came over, and they gathered her up because she was weeping, and they hugged her, and then they shopped with her, and as she was leaving, I said, goodbye. And she gave me no look at all, not even like a look of death. Just I was a non-person to her.
Yeah, yeah. And I hear a lot of regret in that, you know. And I got lots of stories like that of especially that moment of you know, when you decide to help, but you really aren't like trying to be helping.
Right.
You know, you're trying to.
There's
you're
nothing
still trying
in my
to be
voice
like,
that says this is about Jesus.
Yeah. But I wonder, where is the hope in confessing that to all of us? You know, where is the hope in that, and what moves you beyond just feeling bad?
Yeah, and the hope has got to be just in confessing it, right? I mean, and walking away and going, I'm not sure what I was supposed to do, but that couldn't have been it. I'm not sure what the rules at heart are supposed to accomplish, but that doesn't seem like it's it. Mm-hmm. Just confessing, God, I did not draw close to you in that moment, and I'm not sure how to do that differently. Confessing that, and then the next piece is saying, but I want to do it differently next time, God. Show me a way, and that's called repentance, right?
Yeah.
Show me a way to do that differently, that we both feel like we've drawn close to you.
Yeah, and I hear in that story that moment of growth, right? I mean, we talked about stepping off the curb is a growth moment. Confession and repentance is too, because what I hear is that you became more tender and soft rather than hardening. And so, you know, so that the next time someone is before you, and maybe they're the one who's like mad and they don't break down in tears, they just are scream, you are still more tender with them, right? Because of this openness that happens when we confess and repent.
Yeah, I mean, the language that we use in the church is hardened hearts, right? What's that about your hardened heart? And so hardened hearts happen when we stay in the crowd like I did, because that's what I was doing. I get rewarded by others when I follow the rules, because they already think I don't follow the rules enough. So I'm going to hold on to these rules right here. I get people look to me for leadership. So if I'm enforcing these rules, other people will be enforcing these rules, and I'm going to be in this crowd right here rather than step out. Mm-hmm. And when I do stay in that crowd, and when I don't do the thing that brings me close to Jesus, nothing's going to change my heart unless I confess and repent.
Yeah, and I think that is the crux of what James is lifting up, right? That if you're not going to step off the curb, and you're also not going to confess the moments when you didn't, then what is your faith? You know, is it just words? You know, what is living about it?
Your faith is dead.
Yeah.
That's what dead faith looks like. It looks like not only are you not moving towards Jesus, you're also not even feeling like there's a problem being in the crowd.
Yeah.
And that your faith just becomes words that you say, but not actions that you do.
Just get more and more stubborn there and hardened there.
Right? It's about following Jesus, then, right?
Yeah,
and I hearing his call.
Yeah, that all of us, we know, we all walked in today stuck somewhere, right? Stuck with some kind of fears or anger or judgments or whatever it is. And we also walked in with moments where we said, yeah, I did get a chance to step out this week. But whatever that is, wherever we're stuck, you know, when God shows up in that place of dead faith, right? God says, guess what? I resurrect dead things.
Uh-huh.
You know? And that is our entire gospel story, that even while we wind up, you know, following a path where we kept saying, no, I'm hardened, nope. Even in that place where we're finding ourselves dead and decaying, God says, I resurrect dead things.
You know? Yeah, believe it or not, God never tires of hearing my confessions.
Yeah.
Never tires.
Yeah.
And God never stops summoning us to a life of faith.
So the question before us all is, you know, will we put one foot in front of the other and follow Jesus, either with confession or stepping off the curb?
Amen.
Amen.
Thank you.
The peace of the Lord be with you always. Please share God's love and God's peace with one another this morning. Special gift from our Chancel choir. If you want to be part of this handsome group, they sing at 7 on Thursday nights. Talk to Kay.
Please join us.
Find us in this space this morning. Meet us at this wine and bread. Summon us to draw near and change us in that encounter. Oh Lord, forgive us when we don't come near. Forgive us when we stay in the crowd. Forgive us when we ignore your suffering and pain in this world. Lord, we pray for those who are sick or ill. Especially we pray for the continued health of Kathleen Botley, Terry Hanf, Kimberly Berry, Meg Reidler, Harlan Soppy, Christine Ickes, Susan Franklin, Lauren Blake, Holly Hessler, Mary Hodge, Julie Searles, Karen Butler, Tracy Shurick, Roger Solt, Deb Drum, Martha Keplin, Andy Sir, Jennifer Solt, Amanda Patterson, Carl Schweikert, Ed Minette, Carolyn March, and others named aloud now. Lisa, Cassandra. Lord, draw us near. In the night in which our Lord was to be betrayed, he took bread and he broke it and he gave thanks, saying, "Take and eat, this is my body and it's been given for you." And again after supper he took the cup and he blessed it and he gave for all to drink, saying, "This cup is a sign of the new covenant shed in my blood, for you and for all people, for the forgiveness of sin. Do this for the remembrance of me." For as often as we eat this bread and drink this wine, we are proclaiming the very mystery of faith, that Christ has died, Christ is risen, Christ will come again. Come, Spirit, come and fill us, delight us, and send us out with your love, Lord. Come, Spirit, come. Give us the courage to leave the crowd, step off the curb, and embrace your love. Amen.
And
heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, and the power, and the glory, forever and ever. Amen. All are welcome to the table that God has set. If you are visiting today, please know that you are welcome. You can sit down. We're going to commune our assistants first and then commune you. Please come forward and eat with us. The bread we'll serve at the center. The wine are in cups at the other side. And there's grape juice. They have cups already. They don't need cups. And there's grape juice in the center. The body of Christ. Give it to you.
The body of Christ. Give it for you. The body of Christ.
Thank you.
blood of our Lord Jesus Christ strengthen and keep you in his grace.
Amen.
Let us pray. Holy God, met at your table, summoned from our life of death to the resurrected life, send us out now to be your people and notice Jesus in our path. Amen. A few announcements before you scatter. We got people that have been working on subs that are being prepared for us. A little rain isn't going to stop us from having lunch together. So we are inside, obviously, today. But we've got tables set up in the fellowship hall, and we've got tables set up in Fritz Hall. And I think there's more than enough tables for the amount of people that we've got here, more than enough seats, rather. So Fritz Hall, which is the far one, in the fellowship hall. The food is like on Messiah night, where it's right down the middle. But the fixings for the sub sandwiches, hot meat and cheese sandwiches, are going to be in the fellowship hall. The fixings, right? The things on top. Is that what I said? So, yeah, so there won't be quite a clog there. So, and then I think the desserts you're going to find in the fellowship hall, too. The desserts that you people brought. Hopefully there's plentiful of those, too. But I know there's a lot of food. So eat hearty and eat well. If you're visiting today, please stay and eat with us. If you didn't know there was a lunch, surprise, there is. So stay and eat it. And then Betsy's going to organize some games afterwards. And you could still buy raffle tickets for the quilts and things that are out there. And sometime around dessert, we will put a microphone in someone's mouth and we'll announce who wins the quilt, okay? That's it. And then there's a huge ministry fair going on, too. There's about 12 tables down there of people that are passionate about things in this church. Give them the honor of letting them tell you what they're passionate about. And maybe you'll stumble onto something that you didn't know is tugging at your heart. So go around, look at their tables, and talk to them, and give them that honor this morning, too. This thing that I'm holding right here, this is tonight, after you go home, after our lunch together, and you watch the Minnesota Vikings win. You could, and who knows, maybe even the Browns will win today, right? Every squirrel finds a nut. And then you might want to come back at 6 o'clock to Peace Lutheran Church. Brian McLaren, he might not be terribly well known to you, but he's pretty big in the religious writings things. And he does just a lot of thinking about what the church looks like in the modern world and all the changes in the world and what that means for the church and both the hardship of that and the possibilities and God's hope. Pastor Liz and I were fortunate enough to have dinner with him last night, and he's just a guy who's got all sorts of ideas that are thought-provoking. Even when you don't agree with them, you're kind of walking away wondering about it. So he's $10. Unfortunately, he's like a big deal, so it's like $10 to get in. I apologize for that, but if you got $10, go to Peace Lutheran tonight at 6 o'clock and hear what he has to say. They'll take you right at the door. If you want more information, you can go to our website and click on his face right on the front page of the website, and you can read more. Finally, Tuesday, the Rebecca Circle is meeting Tuesday morning. It's in your bulletin board, a nice group of ladies. If you want to join them, they're always looking for more people. Messiah Night is Wednesday. The whole back page of your bulletin board is about Messiah Night. So take a look at that. There's Marty's got a pork thing going on that night and 5:30, and then we got all sorts of education stuff. I'm teaching some. Pastor Liz has got Faith Walk. Our grief group has got something going on. Just an ongoing gift for this church. Please come and eat with us on every Wednesday night at 5:30. We got kids meals too, so your kids will find something they'll like also. And finally, the men's group starts again on Thursday morning at 6:30. If you want to be part of that and you got questions, ask me. It's in the bulletin board too. And that's at Marie Scrambler's. And next Sunday at 9:30, you could come to worship or you could go down to adult Sunday school down there. A wonderful group of
people that will welcome you in there. So all sorts of ways for you to grow your faith in Christ. Why don't you stand up, and we will have our blessing, and then our praise team will lead us out this morning. And now may the Lord bless you and keep you. May the Lord make his face shine on you and be gracious unto you. May the Lord look upon you with favor and grant you God's peace. Amen. Come and eat.